Today we're going to talk about the molecular orbital theory, or the MO theory, for bonding. And the reason why we need to discuss this other model of bonding is basically has to do with the fact that the model that we've used so far, which is the Lewis model for bonding, has problems associated with it. Okay, the Lewis model can't really represent odd number of electrons. So if you have something like NO, which has 11 electrons, you just can't draw a Lewis structure for this. We go molecule and as a result, you can't do anything with that particular molecule. You can't predict its properties or anything else that's associated with that particular molecule. The second one problem with the Lewis model is that you need to use this concept called resonance, or resonance structures, in order to explain certain properties of molecules. When we were talking about resonance, we say that it's a really important concept in the Lewis structure, in the Lewis model for bonding, but resonance structures are not real. What we see in the experiment is the average structure, okay? But we have to include in the Lewis model this concept called resonance in order to be able to explain why we see this average structure, okay? In other words, these structures, which we really can't see, which are not real, but that helps explain what we see in reality, okay? That, of course, is not as great a model as if you can just model reality itself with the molecules there, okay? So this concept of resonance, it's great. It does help to explain the properties of these molecules, but it uses the existence of molecules that really don't, you know, are not present, okay? Now, the third issue is that there are certain properties in molecules. For example, one that we're going to talk about to some extent is magnetism that can't be easily explained if you're just to use the Lewis model for bonding. Okay, so this is why we need to come up with the second model of bonding, which is the MO model. Okay, so before we actually discuss the details of the MO model for bonding, first we need to differentiate between the valence bond and the MO model so that it's clear why we need to talk about this additional model, because sometimes when we discuss it, a lot of the terminologies are very similar between the MO and the valence bond, and mathematically it's also similar in terms of the procedure used to generate these orbitals. So it's really important to kind of understand what exactly is the difference between these two approaches to model bonding. In the valence bond model, remember that molecule is represented as consisting of bonds. These bonds is a result of overlapping atomic orbitals. Okay, so each atom has its own set of valence orbitals, which could be the regular or the hybrid orbitals. And when bonding occurs, each atom takes its own set of valence orbitals and overlaps it with valence orbitals from other atoms. Okay, the difference with the MO model, the molecular orbital model, is the molecule consists of its own set of orbitals called the molecular orbital. So in other words, there's no longer atomic orbitals in the molecule. Okay, we don't have our SPDF, we don't have the hybrid orbitals, we just have this new set of orbitals we call molecular orbitals. So it's sort of saying that the molecule is its own unique entity, as opposed to in the valence bond model, where the molecule is really not necessarily a unique entity, but it's composed of the individual atoms. Okay, here at the bottom I draw an example of what the difference is in terms of, you know, visually representing the molecules. If you have two atoms here, the black and the red atom, the valence bond model basically says that the molecule is just an overlap of these two atoms. So you have the black and the red overlapping their valence orbitals, and there you get the molecule. Okay, with the molecular orbital model, you don't. You get a new set of orbital, and that's why I put it a different color here. I put a yellow color here to represent it, which is different than the black and the red, because now you have a new set of orbital. That orbital is different from what you saw before in the atom. It's not something that was present in the atom. It's only something that's present in the molecule. Okay, this concept is really important to understand the difference between the two models. Okay, so another analogy you can think of is that if you're think about your parents and yourself, right? The valence bond model, you know, one way to imagine the valence bond model is the fact that some of the properties that people see in you is a result of properties that they also see in your parents. For example, maybe you have blonde hair, or you have dark hair, or you have blue eyes or brown eyes, and your parents also have these properties. But in the molecular orbital model would be to say that there's some properties that you have that your parents don't have that are completely unique to you. So for example, maybe you are, let's say, more patient, whereas your parents are not. There are certain properties that you have yourself that were not present in your parents, and that's really the way the molecular orbital represents the molecule versus the valence bond. Okay, so one keyword that's often used to distinguish between the valence bond and the molecular orbital model is these words localized and delocalized. Okay, so the valence bond model is often called a localized electron model, and the MO model is often called the delocalized electron model. So localized just means that the electron is restricted or is fixed at a certain atom, is localized to a certain atom. So if you think about the molecule H2, the valence bond representation would look like this, where you can see clearly the each of the electron belong to one of the hydrogen atoms. So this electron belongs to that, and this electron belongs to this one. So in other words, the electron is localized to specific atoms, okay? Whereas the MO model, if you have hydrogen atom, it would just draw it as that, with nuclei in the middle, okay? Here's your nuclei. But then the electron itself, which is represented here as a yellow color, would just be spread all over the entire molecule, okay? So the electron doesn't necessarily belong to one hydrogen or the other, but it's just spread throughout the entire molecule, okay? So that's why it's called delocalized, because it's not fixed. That's a very key difference between the two models. So the last thing I want to talk about in this video is just this answering this question whether one model, valence bond or MO, is better than the other one. Okay? And the answer is no. Okay? And the valence bond model is oftentimes a simpler way of visualizing molecules, because remember that you can draw Lewis structures and then use the concept you learn in Lewis structure and then represent the bonding with these atomic orbitals overlap, right? And this is extremely useful, especially in organic chemistry. So it's very important for you to understand how to draw these orbitals and how to represent bonding using the valence bond model. The molecular orbital model is much more mathematical, because this is a full quantum mechanical treatment of a molecule. And you can think of it as being more correct, because you use all the quantum mechanical theories and apply it to the molecule. However, a lot of times it's actually, for some molecules, is really complicated to calculate, and then the results are not as clear-cut as the ones represented by the valence bond model. In some cases, it may make more sense to use the valence bond, especially if you're talking about molecular shape, you're talking about polarity, very easy to predict using valence bond. But if you're talking about trying to predict magnetism, okay, bond strength, bond length, and odd number of electrons, then it's a lot easier to use the MO model to explain bonding that you observe. Okay, so in other words, again, you want to think of these two theories as complementary to each other, not necessarily competing with each other.